So back here with Sarah Bookalis, local democracy reporter, and we're gearing up for Christmas now, aren't we? And Yummy's pizza licensing review first, then. Let's go on to food. What's all that about at licensing committee?
This is a very unusual situation. My Yummy Pizza in Salt Dean, just your standard local little takeaway place. They had an extra inspection. There was a fight there. They had applied for an extra late license, which is a bit unusual outside of the city centre, but they wanted it for delivery only. And because of this fight and also some other intelligence that Sussex Police Licensing Department have received, they did some cocaine sweeps around the place. And it turned out some really high levels in the toilet in particular. The readings the machine gives will tell you if the surface has been in contact with bulk amounts. So basically, if someone has sort of made a line on the toilet seat or on the back of the loos, it will register on there. And it was showing bulk amounts in the toilet, on the toilet seat, on the cistern, on the sink, on the soap dispenser, all over both loos. But also there were trace elements on the till as well. So this is where something has been in contact and then touched it. Now, most of us in Brighton Hove, we've been to the city centre restaurants and pubs. And when you go in there, you often notice there is no cistern, or they're all blocked in, and there's a lack of surfaces. I went to a restaurant on Friday, and particularly because this was coming up, I noticed the lack of flat surfaces on dryers because they just want to stop this cocaine. Now, you don't expect it in Salt Dean, in a little local takeaway. Now, what this licensing review is likely to mean, it won't mean the shop's going to close down. It's a look at its late license to allow the deliveries after 11 o'clock because they don't sell alcohol. So it is just a little neighbourhood place delivering Salt Dean and to the east of the city and to an extent into Brighton as well. Apparently their chicken nuggets are really good. This is what I've heard from people in Salt Dean. So it is unusual for police to take readings at takeaways. Bars and restaurants in the city centre, yes. Here, no. So it's going to be an interesting hearing.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, drug use is sky high in Brighton anyway, isn't it? So I'm not surprised it's reached Salt Dean. I do know where you mean at Yummy's as well. I've got some friends in Salt Dean.
Yes, you expect it in the city centre at bars and also along Church Road. It's been a known issue at a number of places there. But the owners are much more aware of cracking down. I remember, I think it was Gin Tub. They put AstroTurf on the back of their toilet seats just to try and stop people because they knew they had a problem. But I think they've got over that now. But it is a fight for these places.
Yeah. What about Policy and Resources Committee? They're moving on to that. And about the Kingsway to the Sea and Moulsecoomb hub as well, redevelopment, the housing there. I did speak to Fahim about this, leader, Fahim McCafferty, leader of the council, particularly about Kingsway. There's a lot of money going in there, isn't there? Millions.
Yes. The government has given the council $9.5 million.
A lot
of money. Putting in another million. And this is to improve the park area and the sports facilities between King Alfred and the Lagoon. Now, at Policy and Resources last week, all the councillors were just absolutely thrilled with this because that part of the city, it does feel neglected sometimes, particularly when you look at the green spaces. So it's going to be re-landscaped, there's going to be better parks, some of the buildings along the seafront are going to get a bit of regeneration. And they just hope that they're going to improve the dilapidated infrastructure and just make the area more attractive. It is growing in popularity, particularly since the Rock Water had its huts along there. It's people have always liked walking along there, but it's attracting a bit more attention. So what we'll be looking at hopefully is some beach tennis courts, croquet, improved tennis courts, and a pump track and improved skate park, because the skate park is at the lagoon, but hopefully in one of the square places along the western end of Hove. And a pump track, that's the sort of thing that you see at the Olympics for the BMXs. And another one's going in at Black Rock as well. So this is great for the young people who enjoy a bit of BMX, maybe be inspired by the Olympic BMX riders and pump around. So the other big one is Moulsecoomb Hub. Again, there was a lot of love for this. Councillor Daniel Yates, who represents Moulsecoomb and Bevendean, he was just so enthusiastic because it is what the area has been crying out for. Family homes. A lot of them have been lost as people have sold up after Right to Buy, and there are a lot of student homes there. So as a member of the planning committee, he did say he was very frustrated he won't get to vote on it because he has declared his love for the Moulsecoomb Hub. But he does plan to speak about it, and it's going to come up at planning next year. Now, also, Steve Bell, the Conservative leader, he was fully enthusiastic. He always talks about people having their own front door. It is so important. And we have so many people, thousands of people on the housing waiting list. Now, it's 211 homes. It's not going to put a great dent in it, but it's at least some form of a dent. Yeah. And finally, if David Gibson, he spoke about the rents, because I know that's something we've spoken about in the past. So Housing Committee Chair David Gibson, he is feeling very positive that this new these new houses will have lower rents, because the council has had some positive noises from Homes England, which will give it grants. Now, he is frustrated that it's going to be living wage rents rather than social. He said the government calls it social rent, but it's not what he would call social rent, which is something like, oh gosh, 20% of market value, whereas the living wages are about sort of 30-35%, but it's still significantly less than what people would pay on the market in Brighton and Hove. And that can only be good news for low-income families.
Yeah, good. Also with Daniel Yates then, about the budget management, usage budget management debate. Again, speaking to Fanny McCafferty, we've got about a 10 million budget deficit. I did speak to some the leader of the Labour, well, the co-leaders of the Labour Party. They think it might be a bit more than that. But either way, we're going to have budget cuts to services starting from next year, Sarah, I would say.
Yes, the budget situation is looking very worrying for over the next 4 years, really. Now, at the moment, just looking at the this year's targeted budget management, it is going over, but the acting head of finance, he is pretty sure that they can pull it back this year. But what they're still dealing with is the fallout of the cost of COVID. And one of the things that came up that was brought up by Daniel Yates is concessionary bus fares. And the council was effectively paying for empty seats on buses because only 60% of the capacity of the concessionary bus fares is actually being used. Because quite frankly, a lot of elderly and disabled bus users are still very nervous about getting on public transport. And of course, now we've got the added Omicron development. We've got it in the city now. It is a worry, especially when people are vulnerable. Many of them may be vaccinated, but still, you know, vaccine is no guarantee when you have serious health issues or you are older. Yes, one of the things that did come up about this is that the Brighton and Hove sort of equivalent councils across the country, they pay half of what Brighton and Hove does for concessionary fares. And we pay about £40 each. And it is a bit strange that we pay so much more than, say, somewhere like Bristol, which is a very similar city to ours. And so what the finance bosses have said is they are going to keep an eye on these contracts the council is paying out for when not receiving a service due to COVID. It was something Councillor Yates described as the cost of COVID, paying for empty buses. But also the council has been paying for the school dinner contractors, which, you know, it's had its vouchers to give to families for who receive free school meals. But the school dinner contractors also, people pay for their school meals as well. So they've still paid that contract when the kids haven't been at school. And also Freedom Leisure, the leisure centres were closed for months on end and they needed financial support. So it's this that is still being paid for, but not necessarily covered by funding.
Yeah, I did speak to John Alcock and Carmen at Pitch about this as well yesterday with the bus issue. And I know that they're calling for cheaper centre fares as well, cheaper bus fares anyway. And I think they're going to be speaking to the new chief executive of Brighton Hove Bus about that. I mean, but buses, we do have a brilliant bus network, but it can be a bit pricey. Did that come up during the debate as well? The actual cost?
Well, it a little bit, not really quite so much. But yeah, I mean, it can be pretty expensive for people that catch buses on a regular basis. We do have a great bus system. And when Daniel Yates referred to paying for empty buses, I have seen some comments from people saying, but yeah, all the buses are really full. Yes, buses like the one, the seven, the fives, they're always rammed. But it's your 37. I mean, who knows where the 37 goes? I have seen it. It's been a bit of an unfair situation. If the recovery had done what it was supposed to do without COVID, then I think it would be okay. But
yeah. All right, we're going to leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be back with Sarah Booker-Lewis to talk a lot more about local issues. Join us then. So back here with Sarah Booker-Lewis, and we're going to talk in this second half of the vote to talk about special educational needs budget. I mean, financing is going to dominate the council anyway, isn't it? When we, for December, January, February, up until the actual budget final discussions in late February.
Yes, it's that most wonderful time of the year when everyone starts looking at their budgets ready for the next financial year. Now, there is a group of head teachers, governors and council officers that meet every few months called the Schools Forum. And this week there has been quite an in-depth discussion about what they call the high needs block. Basically, this is young people with special educational needs and disabilities. And nationally, this area has got problems because the assistant director in charge of this, she said the funding is inadequate. It's nationally. And the National Special Educational Needs and Disabilities Spending Review is delayed. She knows they need more funding. Because one of the great issues with this is there has been a massive increase in demand. This has been driven by better diagnosis, better understanding of autistic spectrum conditions. We've seen in the national news recently, Melanie Sykes, the TV presenter, has had a diagnosis of autism after her children had the same. And it almost feels like it's almost more commonplace to be neurodiverse than it is to be neurotypical. And the numbers have increased by, hundreds. It was about 150 every year up until 2015. And now last year, 350 young people had a statement and educational health and care plan, which is the ECHP, that's the term that people use all the time, that had autistic spectrum conditions. That's more than double in a year in just the space of 6 years. And as well as that, the council is now having to deal with young people with these care plans up to the age of 25, but hasn't received any additional funding. So at the moment, Brighton and Hove's current spending is 400,000 over the top. Now, what has also happened nationally and locally is more parents are appealing and taking to tribunals council's decisions on where their young people should be going to school. And more young people are going to independent maintained special schools as well as special schools. And this is putting pressure on budgets. An independent special school costs about £5,000 a week. And the number of young people going to these schools has increased again since 2018 from 68 to 95. That's a hell of a strain on the council budget. But the important thing is these young people, they need support and education so that they can move forward and become productive members of society. Yeah. But that comes at a cost because they need the help and support to bring them through a lot more than your average kid does. And even they need a lot of help. They cost.
Yeah, exactly. So that's quite a difficult issue then. And I don't know what service is going to be for potentially cut in the new year, but it's going to be difficult because there's been a lot of cutting already around kind of, things like, flowers and the kind of the horticultural side of the council services. You can see there's been cutbacks in regards to, flower beds, etc. around Palmyra Square, can't you? So it's...
Yes, I see a lot of people complaining about, we used to have lovely flower beds, but basically when it comes down to it, it's functional services, looking after the elderly, supporting children and just getting things done. So yeah, unfortunately, a nice row of daffodils doesn't cut the mustard when it comes to spending a few grand.
Yeah, exactly. Key performance indicators, repairs and refuse collections. Repairs, is it true, 7,000 repairs due to be carried out on council owned property, housing property? It's absolutely ginormous.
It's a huge number of repairs. With repairs, only 70% of the council homes had their repairs completed within 28 days in the last quarter. That is really way off target. Yeah. Now, what councillors were told by Rachel Sharp, who is the director of housing, is that if the council keeps up with its repairs process as it is at the moment, they should clear that backlog in 6 months. But whether or not that will happen is another thing, because that's a hell of a lot of strain. That's a lot of work for the workers who are in the in-house maintenance team. And also, that team is understaffed as well. They have got a lot of vacancies. So the council is recruiting, and they need recruitment. They need the specialists out there. This backlog occurred because the repairs workers, they couldn't really go into houses when we were social distancing. So it was the health and safety and emergency work that was carried out rather than the general maintenance that really needed to be done. And the backlog is gigantic.
Yeah, so I don't see that being fixed anytime soon either. Obviously, this comes after it got transferred into back into the council's hands, the contract.
Yes, indeed. And that was where the vacancy issues flared up, because some people didn't move with the contract. So that doesn't help.
Yeah, I know councillors sharing their views on the budget for next year. I mean, we've heard some of those views already. But yeah, it's going to be a lot of horse trading going on in February, isn't there? And people are going to miss out.
Yes, I think there'll be a lot less fun stuff going into the budget this year. Usually the debate is around nice things that we could have. I mean, last year, one of the big discussions was spending about £100,000 on pretty Brighton and Hove and Port Slade signs for people to take their pictures next to, like the ones that say like I Heart Amsterdam and so on. But yeah, less pretty stuff. It's going to be down to the nitty gritty now.
Yeah, exactly. Now, this is interesting. The school's admissions, we know there might be a process at the next town hall council meeting. I've spoken to a parent about this at Carden Primary School, as well as Councillor Alice McNair and Labour councillors. It's a big issue, isn't it? The PAN numbers was the primary school.
Yes, it does seem like four of the schools have really started banging the drum to fight this.
Yeah.
Now, at the moment, there are four petitions on the council website, and three of these have now reached the threshold for a debate at full council. So even though that's Whittingdean, Carden, and the other one is Bevendean, I can't see them really ignoring Rudyard Kipling. Rudyard Kipling have added 200 to their petition since I last looked. So they're beating the drum for that. I have seen this morning that Councillor Dee Simpson is at the Rudyard Kipling consultation meeting as well. There have been a lot of parents attending the consultation meetings. They are really anxious. I've been speaking to parents from all of the schools. They are so anxious about the loss of funding and the potential for having mixed ages in the classes. And in particular, in Whittingdean and also in Hollingbury, if the Whittingdean schools get oversubscribed, where else are the children going to go? So if they're both down to 45, so that's 90 children. If there are 96 children applying for a primary school in Whittingdean in reception, where are the other six going to go? Because, Whittingdean is a fair old way away. And then the next nearest, we're looking at East Brighton, St Mark's and St John the Baptist and Whitehawk. So, it's that is an extra financial pressure that some of the families could face. And that's why they're very anxious. I also know that I've talked to Bridget Fishley, who is talking with parents in Saltdean. They haven't really raised their voices quite so much at the moment. But one of the things that Councillor Fishley is concerned about is the number of new developments in the Salt Dean area and also down in Rottingdean, St Albans, that are really aimed at families, and that's bringing new people in. So if that school shrinks down to 2 form entry from 3, then that could cause some problems with people getting oversubscription. And that is the issue. I also had a chat with Amanda Evans for Queen's Park, and I asked her if there's much of a protest going on there. And she hasn't heard anything. I haven't heard anything keeping my ear to the parental drum at the moment either. But talking to parents from these other schools where they are concerned and worried, they're wondering if maybe they think parents are thinking, well, Queen's Park, there are other choices in the area. There are other schools, the Hanover schools, the East Brighton schools, that aren't quite so far away. So yes, parents are planning to protest outside Hove Town Hall next Thursday from 4 o'clock. So it'll be interesting to see how many turn up. But eventually in January, when this consultation comes forward, it'll be interesting to see if the many thousands that sign the petitions are transferred into filled-in consultation forms.
Yeah, exactly. Just before we finish up, but briefly, consultation on Value Gardens Phase 3, that is due to start next year. I got that confirmed by a leader of the council yesterday. So that's taking place. Not sure how that's going to work out. We've got a roundabout being replaced by traffic lights. So I just think traffic jams, but I might be wrong.
Well, I mean, the thoughts of the roundabout being replaced by a T-junction,
yeah,
that has been cited as adding an extra 40 seconds to journeys from east to west. That may not seem much.
Surprise. Yeah.
To us,
yeah.
But actually to a traffic engineer, that's actually quite a lot.
Yeah. Okay. We'll leave it there. Sarah, speak to you next week. Thanks.
Thank you.